Different modeling approaches have different pros and cons. MoAI 3D or XNURBS uses a NURBS approach, so think infinite resolution like curves. Magicka Voxel uses a voxel approach, so very versatile but can lack the modeling precision that you get with curves. Atom Montage is another voxel example and gives some examples of the pros and cons right there on the homepage. The amazing Media Molecule Dreams game takes a unique approach with distance fields, I think it is, and there are many wild examples that people create in there. Those various modeling engines don't use a polygonal approach like Blender. The thought process behind creating in those other applications, if applied to Blender, might completely mess up our model. In Blender 2.9, there is a new extrude manifold tool that has been included that almost gives us a kind of flexibility that we may not be used to as polygonal modelers. And that will come into the picture here shortly. The new extrude manifold tool, and in other cases, the 3D print toolbox add-on, are the main saviors for us in this polygonal-based world. To start us off in this video, let's take a look at some polygonal-based horrors and how to avoid them. One of the curses of the polygon is that it isn't a real physical thing. It's more of a lighting trick than a physical thing. It isn't like, say, a flat piece of card in the real world. That means, though, that we can do amazing things that the universe might not, and that's great. But it also means we can fall into some unintuitive traps, dark mystical stuff in 3D that isn't really allowed in the real world. One of the most simple and common ways the curse of the polygon manifests itself is with two polygonal faces set right on top of each other. If I select this face here, we can see we've just got one of one faces selected. And if I go Shift D to duplicate it, and then right click just to cancel the translation part of it and drop it right back where the other one was, we can see we've got two faces now. But as you can clearly see, they're set right on top of each other. This is impossible to do in the real world, say with a couple of pieces of card, for example. Card has thickness, while a polygon doesn't. It's infinitely thin. It's a true size zero. Blender actually handles this example very gracefully, though. Right now, from a visual point of view, it actually looks fine. We wouldn't know of the horrors lurking beneath, or rather within the surface. I'm just going to make sure that this toggle X-ray isn't enabled, though, and we can do that with Alt-Z with the shortcut. And as we can see, it still looks fine. But if we give one of these faces an edge loop with Control R, you can see things start to get a bit angry. Again, just to emphasize the X-ray mode, if we go Alt Z, it's not as obvious there. So I'm just going to press Alt Z again. And now we get into this angry sort of thing. And anger leads to fighting, Z fighting to be precise, which is this bit of flickery trouble we're seeing on screen right now. Since the faces are in exactly the same space, Blender doesn't know which one to show, so this flickery shimmering paradox is the result. This is pretty inconvenient, not just because it probably is not the visual result we want, but because it makes any modeling we want to do way more confusing. Because which face, edge, or vertex are we really trying to operate on when there's two lots in exactly the same space? When we have twin geometry like this, how do we know we're not accidentally selecting the wrong evil twin? Basically, it's modeling nightmare material, but it's super simple to fix if it's just two faces in the same space. So first of all, I'm going to select this edge and dissolve it. So X, and then dissolve that edge. And then I like to check down here just to make sure the vertices option is also enabled, or maybe with F9 from time to time. And now that edge is gone. To fix this double face issue, assuming this was more within a sea of faces and not quite as obvious as this, because we could just select and then delete the face, of course, and then that's problem solved. But imagine this in a sea of faces, we could just select all and then press M to merge and then choose the by distance option. Now this nasty two-faced geometry is automatically cleaned up into one wholesome, trustable face. Let's imagine for a second that we're not being very careful and we've somehow invited this curse into our 3D geometry's home. So we're back with two polygons right on top of each other and one has an edge down the middle. So we can see that glitchy Z fighting. If we now try to fix the problem with merge by distance, we'll still be left with these faces. Notice the vertex count, we're at 6 at the moment. If I just undo that, we were at 10. And then if I redo with Control Shift Z, we can see we're back down to 6. And we're sort of left with this kind of geometry if I just lift this up for a second and peek beneath the murky depths. Now let's crank up the anxiety and dissolve that extra edge. Here's where things get a lot more sticky. There's two faces now, but only four vertices. Merge by distance will no longer work to rid us of that extra face and will ignore our cries for help. At first, maybe it seems okay. Blender does a pretty good job of rendering this after all, but that isn't to say it isn't still gonna give us problems. If we try to do any modeling with this, using K for the knife tool, for example, or Control R for an edge loop, we can see if we switch to vertex selection, we got an extra vertex, but no edge to connect, and the knife tool failed completely. So first of all, I'm going to get rid of these two vertices that were created when the edge loop tool didn't quite work, so X to dissolve them. We're still left with two faces when clearly we should just have one. So first of all, I'm going to come out of this kind of completely full screen mode with Control Alt and space, and then just go Control space so that we still maximize our view here, but we still got access to some of our menus here. So let's see how we might be able to remedy this. In the mesh and cleanup menu here, I was a little surprised to see that there's nothing going to help us in our particular case now, or at least as far as I'm aware anyway. And as well as in the select menu, we can go select all by trait. There isn't anything that's going to help us here either. To stress that in this example, it's fairly obvious what we need to do. We could just select this face and delete it, and then problem solved. But what about if we didn't know exactly where this sort of geometry was and needed to hunt it down? So I'm going to undo that just to bring the problem back. And really, we need to break out some bigger guns, particularly with our 3D print toolbox add-on that comes bundled with Blender. But we need to make sure we open our preferences, which I'll do with F4, and then come over to our add-ons tab. And if we just type in print and just make sure that's enabled there, we'll then find it show up in our sidebar under the 3D print section here. Just before we use this though, I'm going to add a different context as this is a very overly simplified example. So let's make it slightly more complicated at least. So from the top view here, I'm going to E to extrude this and then extrude out the rest of the faces actually. Because I have the F2 add-on enabled, it means that I can come over and just select this one vertex and press F and then right click to leave it in position. And we can easily create quads in these corners each time we press F. And then I'm going to press Alt Z just to make sure we're in X-ray mode, and then just duplicate those with Shift D. So we've kind of got our original problem over here, just a very simple two faces sat on top of each other. As you can see there, we've got two selected. And then we have this example on the left where it's not so isolated and it's running off into additional geometry. If we run a check all, we'll see we have some bad contiguous edges and we also have some non-manifold edges. We can click on these to find out where they are. So our bad contiguous edges are right here, and the non-manifold edges are actually around the edge of this geometry as well, which is nothing to worry about actually, because even if we add a plane in here and just move it out of the way for a second, and then deselect that with Alt A and then check all for this object, you can see we've got non-manifold edges there. And if we click them, clearly they're the boundary edges. So nothing to worry about there. So if we come back to this and check all again. So the fact that we have these non-manifold edges on the inside of our geometry is a little bit of a problem. And bad contiguous edges, as it terms these ones here, are also something that we need to keep an eye on. So we found problematic areas, but to fix them is another matter. There's no way that I'm aware of currently that will automatically convert our results and abilities to select them here like this into easily deleting the faces causing the problem. It's the old-fashioned manual selection process in these cases. Selecting these faces and just pressing X to delete them is the way to go. Then when we check for errors, we get these non-manifold edges, but they're all around the boundary of that, so that's fine. If, on the other hand, you had a really bad case where thousands of faces were like this, that's obviously going to take some time, but maybe you have bigger problems to worry about if you manage to get into that sort of trouble. But considering that we can run a script like this to find these sorts of edges that are showing us that we have a problem with our mesh, it stands to reason that it should be possible to also script something that can convert that into a face selection to be deleted. So I remain optimistic for that sort of development for the future. So for this example, let's start with a simple plane, and I've switched to a more neutral colored matte cap for this example. And also we can currently see both sides, so I don't have backface culling enabled anymore. That's just to make a point about extruding from this plane. So let's make sure we have this face selected and just press E to extrude out like this, which I'm betting is probably the direction that you would always extrude. But a beginner, I think, could be just as likely to extrude down the opposite way too. And would probably see nothing wrong with this. But if you have some experience with Blender, seeing me extrude down like that was the modeler equivalent of rubbing the cat's fur the wrong way. Let's undo this and get a better look at this by turning on the face orientation overlay. Now blue is going to show the front of the face and red is going to show the reverse side of that. That's the side which would be culled if we were to enable that. So to repeat that again, if we extrude up, you can see everything is fine, everything is blue as it should be. But if we extrude down instead, we can see everything is red, this angry, dangerous red. If at this point we disable our face orientation and also enable our backface culling, you might be able to see that basically the box has been flipped inside out. Not a huge deal really, but like we saw when modeling with two polygons sat in the same place, we'll get modeling problems here too, especially with booleans and so on. So we do need to be careful and know which way polygons are facing. We'll also come across issues if you want to export the object into a game engine, where backface culling is usually the default for game materials. This is fairly simple to fix though. We just bring up our normals menu with Alt and N, and we'll be able to make our polygons nice and consistent with our recalculate outside. But it would help if we had anything selected. Sometimes, of course, if you're modeling the interior of a room, for example, though, you might want to choose recalculate inside. Or we've also got the option to just flip what we've got selected. All right, so not so scary, hopefully. But let's increase our modeling anxiety a little by doing a super common mistake, and that's using the extrude tool and forgetting that this tool is two tools in one. It's extrude and move. So when we cancel with either the escape key or the right mouse button, we've only cancelled the second part of the operation, the move part, not the extrude. Visually, everything looks fine and dandy, but hidden horrors lay within. Now we basically have our starting problem all over again, where we've got two faces sat right on top of each other, and we have a load of squished up geometry. So a bunch of geometry that had zero area. Using the 3D print toolbox again, it's pretty simple to track these problems down, but that's probably overkill. All we really need to correct these sorts of issues is a simple select all and then M to merge by distance. And then if we just check all again, everything's fine. Perhaps something worse than extruding and then not realizing that you've left that squished up geometry all sat on top of itself in place is taking a box like this. So I've undone that again. So it's just a box with this edge loop that runs down the center of it and turning that into a shape like this. Before 2.9, we may have taken one or two approaches. So for example, just added a horizontal edge loop and then maybe deleted the vertices belonging to this edge and then select this edge and then press F a couple of times. Or probably simpler is to drop the height down a little bit and then simply just extrude up one of the sides. Another option would be just to throw caution to the wind and just do some extruding into existing geometry. But this gets very messy very quickly, and it's definitely not immediately clear what requires to be done to clean that up. But now Blender has introduced a new tool in 2.9, which allows us to essentially rub the fur the wrong way and not be mauled to death by our geometry. So taking a look at this shape here, we can just take this top face and extrude down. Because if we look in the tool now, we have an option to dissolve orthogonal edges. And that looks like it does a pretty good job to approximate that kind of shape. It's not all plain sailing though, because the model in C's can get a bit choppy here. Because if we take a look at this side face, part of it is squished up, as we can see along there. So to correct this, we could add an extra vertex onto the vertical edge. So let's select that edge there, right click, subdivide, and then I've got an extra vertex there. Then we can enable our auto merge, and then I can make sure that I'm on vertex snapping, and then press G, hold control, snap it to that vertex, and now that's all nicely welded. And we've not got any strange squished up faces anymore. So that's all problem solved, or at least it would be, apart from we'd need to kind of do the same thing to the other side. So instead of actually taking that approach, I'm going to undo a few steps until we're just left with this again. So instead of using the checkbox, if we just switch over to the extrude manifold tool, which we can find if we long press the extrude region, we get this little menu and we can switch over to extrude manifold. Now we can see a little gizmo to show that we're in that tool now. Then if we try that same extruding down like that and then switch to our selection and then just test that vertex again, you can see it's all nicely automatically welded for us on both sides. So I think the safest bet is to use the extrude manifold tool rather than, for example, pressing E and then moving a little and then enabling the checkbox. One final note is that it's not always straightforward to extrude out. Context is everything as usual. So extruding here is perfectly fine. But if we're going to extrude out here on obscure already created faces, then keep in mind that that isn't a particularly clean modeling style either. If we move this out of the way, we can see we have this face here. We can use our 3D print add-on to check for potential problematic areas. And it has picked up that something's a bit weird with this area. So let's undo that extrude, move back over to the extrude manifold tool and try the same thing again. Switch back to select and we'll see what we've got. In fact, let's go to X-ray with Alt Z and we're in face select mode. And we can see that there is definitely no face right here. In fact, let's try a different view. Just hide these two with the H key. And we can see there's no face there. That's all looking pretty good. I think the tool is still going to pick up a little bit of a problem though. So let's see what two faces it's referring to there. It's just this down at the bottom and at the back. I think that just has to do with us needing to connect these with the J key. And I'll do a Control R edge loop there and then connect these with J and then at the bottom with J. And then let's do another check and all of that has gone away. So it was a little bit sensitive there and we didn't really need to clean that up, but it satisfied the 3D print tool add-on check all. So this is going to be especially harsh and critical. And in a lot of cases, it's going to be that useful first step in resolving modeling nightmares. And then we can sleep easy.